ask that those seated next to you that we may have record of everyone's attendance. There will be a session meeting tonight at 6 p.m. And as we look into the future on Wednesday evening, we will have a program after the dinner, Missions Near and Far, what we're doing as a congregation with missions. In addition to that, we'll have a focus on the Call Commission and how that project of inviting members into responding to the call of the Holy Spirit to say yes to ministry and service in this church, how that's going on. There is a misprint in the bulletin. It says that the Prady Street Acre of Grace event for children and their families, and that means kindergartners through fifth grade, it's misprinted in the bulletin as being on June 11th. It really is this coming weekend, Friday, Saturday night. So men of the church are encouraged to be present to assist with that. And the children and their families are certainly going to receive notification that this event is going on Saturday morning at 10:45. After the kids have had a great overnight there, they will conclude with a brief dedication service to dedicate a little garden area that has a picnic table with it at the community garden in memory of Greg Bordelo. I would like to call Debbie for activities. Jason, if you want to say anything about the call commission before Debbie comes forward, that'd be great.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, Call Commission is looking pretty good. It really is. We've got this weekend and next weekend before we finally wrap up Call Commission. I was hoping for 15 names. We've got over 30. So we're looking good. These are ministries out in the narthex that are in need of your help. There is also an addendum sheet. One of our folks, I met with Glenn Harvey. Yes. I met with Glenn Harvey last week. He gave me some really good ideas. I don't know if you know this, but Glenn's career was based on getting volunteers, large groups of volunteers, involved in projects. So Glenn gave me a few pointers. In response to his pointers, which were excellent, there's an insert in your bulletin for one of the ministries that we think is very important here that needs your help. So there is the youth ministry here at Waldensian Presbyterian. Take a look at that. Pray about it. If you see something that jumps off the page at you, put your name down. Put it on the table right out there where the call commission boards are. I'll pick it up, and we'll move forward. But so far, we are really blessed and pleased. We've got a lot of names, a lot of folks who are going to help us out. And I think God's at work through this call commission. Thank you.
I'd also like to call Debbie Carew forward to share with us some information. After a long season, folks, of saying goodbye to John Mode at the end of June last year and being then in interim time, we are now at the end of that interim and delighted to introduce to you this morning permanent staff. I shouldn't use the word full-time because they're both part-time, but permanent staff. And so, Debbie, if you want to do that.
Thank you. Barbara, would you mind standing, please? I did tell her to ask her to stay in a second. Foreign Affairs Brinkley has been our guest organist several times since last fall, most recently playing for our Christmas cantata in December. Many of you may already be familiar with and friends with Fern, as she was organist here from 1981 to 1990. During that time, Fern served on the committee that selected the builder of this pipe organ. While on the staff at our church, Fern returned to the Appalachian State University Hayes School of Music while teaching private piano and organ lessons. Fern holds a Bachelor of Music in Organ Performance with a concentration in Sacred Music from the Hayes School of Music, Appalachian State University in Boone, graduating in 1989 with advanced organ studies with Dr. Max Smith. Fern was also a member of the Gamma Beta Phi Honor Society at ASU. Fern has served many churches as either organist, pianist, or interim organist. Some of those include St. Luke's Methodist Hickory, Corinth Church of Christ Hickory, First Methodist Lenore, First Methodist Morganton, and First Methodist Newton. For the past 10 years, she has served as organist for Lutheran churches in the Hickory area. Fern is currently a member of the First Methodist Church in Hickory. Fern grew up in the Presbyterian Church in Pineville, North Carolina. She started playing for church in her teens, graduating from South Mecklenburg High School in Charlotte, where she was accompanist for the choral program for 3 years. She received the Chorus Award her senior year, was voted most talented, senior superlative, and was a member of the National Honor Society. She completed 3 years at Western Carolina University, where she was awarded a music scholarship. Fern played the early services and sang in the 11 o'clock services at the Colloy Methodist Church. She was also a member of the Chamber Singers, Concert Choir, and Sigma Kappa Sorority. Professional affiliations include the American Guild of Organists, Presbyterian Association of Musicians, National Federation of Music Clubs, and the Valdese Music Club, where she served for 22 years in offices including Vice President, Second Vice President, and Secretary. Fern has 3 children, April, Bridget, and Donnie, and many grandchildren. She has lived in Hickory for many years and still teaches private lessons. She has tried retirement, but is most happy when she is playing and working with choirs. Fern would like you to know that she is delighted to be back at Waldensian Presbyterian Church and looks forward to serving this congregation. We are pleased that Fern has agreed to join us again, and we look forward to her beautiful music. Please join me in welcoming Fern. Cantata 78, Mozart's Requiem, Haydn's
Harmony Ness and has been seen in roles such as Fernando in Così fan tutte and the title role in Leonard Bernstein's Candide, as well as multiple roles in musical theater. Leslie's professional affiliations include the Presbyterian Association of Musicians, Association of Lutheran Church Musicians, North Carolina Music Educators Association, and Kappa Delta Pi International Honor Society in Education. Leslie and his new bride Amanda were married this past December 12th. Amanda is currently choir director and organist in an outlaw church. Let's please offer a warm welcome to Leslie.
Glory of God.
And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings,
knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us.
Because God's love has been poured into our hearts
through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us, in the shadow of God's peace, in the powerful name of Jesus, and with the help of the Holy Spirit, we worship our triune God.
Amen.
sea of interest in the Waldensian church. We'll throw that aside, okay. What do I have here? Water. Okay.
That's good.
What do I have here?
I want y'all, and my hands are clean, and they're going to just touch. I want you to take a little tiny piece. Take a piece. A little tiny piece. What's happening?
Is it staying the same?
No.
Is it melting?
Yes.
What do you have now?
Water.
You have water? Oh, okay. I'm going to put this down.
I'll let you. Well, can you hold my microphone? Thank you so much. All right. Now, when you heat up water in something like this to make tea, what do you have? What's that? What's that vapor called? Steam? It's called steam. And I've got a little steam there. Can you rub your finger inside of that? And what do you have there? What? It feels warm, but what is it? Is it dry or is it wet?
Dry.
It's dry. No, it's wet. And it's, you try it again. You got to get this right for the grown-ups, because they have a hard time understanding this. It's wet, and it's water, too. So, what we have here is occasionally, do your parents say you need to do something, but you don't really understand why? That happens to you sometimes, okay? Grown-ups have problems, too. And one of the things we do when we pray is we pray to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And some of you may have trouble understanding that, but I can tell you, these big people out here have trouble with it too. And that's why Jesus said, you will not be explained everything there is on this earth. You will come to understand a little bit later. But maybe when we talk about, and the minister's going to talk, Kevin's going to talk about the Trinity, we can think about God as being the water, because water is kind of everywhere, isn't it? And water gives life. And when water created a concrete form like you have in your hands, we can see it very easily. That can be looked upon as Jesus. And this vapor that we saw that turned into water can be thought about as the Holy Spirit. And for grown-ups, that's very hard, but I want you, when your parents are struggling with things and they don't understand stuff in church, I want you to be able to tell them, just remember the water, and remember that water is life and God loves us, and I think that you will help them understand better than they can understand themselves. And as they said in Isaiah, a little child will lead them. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, on this Trinity Sunday, we hope that we will come to understand better and help us to take these simple examples like water and help us understand about the way you are. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Y'all have a good day, right? We're done.
like to share with you some concerns that have all happened within the last 48 hours that we've been aware of. Claude Kevin Christenberry, who was the son of Linda Braswell, died in a fire on Friday night. He was 45 years old. She is a member of this church, and he had gone to another church. But we remember Linda in this great loss in her life. It's one of the absolute worst experiences for a parent is for a parent to bury a child. So we remember Linda, and if you know her, I believe on Tuesday night, they will have the receiving of friends. Because there is an autopsy with this type of death, of a house fire, the plans are uncertain at this point, but it will probably be sometime late Wednesday when that funeral occurs, perhaps and most likely not in this church. We did get word yesterday morning also of the death of Hattie Rostam. Hattie was one day short of being 91 years old, and her family was gathering to be able to celebrate with a picnic at Trinity Ridge where she was. Fortunately, I had just seen Hattie 2 days before. I had preached on the Trinity at Trinity Ridge on Thursday at 10 a.m. and visited with Hattie for a number of minutes afterwards. She was alert and even on Saturday night was talking with her daughter at 3 in the morning and then, or Friday night, and then early Saturday morning at 7 a.m. died. Her plans, the plans I just learned from the family, are they will have receiving from 7 to 9 on Tuesday, a graveside service on Wednesday at 1 p.m. They'd like to have service here at 1:30. Then yesterday afternoon, we had the wedding of Jane Burris and Kevin Dart. They were married here in the congregation in the sanctuary yesterday, and we were delighted to have that wonderful event here. It was certainly a glorious time. I learned as I was preparing for that wedding that my mother is now in the hospital with a heart condition. They initially thought it was a heart attack, but they've ruled that out after testing yesterday. So it's been a busy weekend. We also want to remember the Dolores Waldensian Church in Dolores, Uruguay. This church, a couple of weeks ago, was struck by a tornado that literally destroyed the church, all except for several of the walls of the church. In talking with the pastor down there, I've learned that they were uninsured, and our church is looking, our session tonight will be voting on a way in which we can offer some support to them as they seek to rebuild. We also want to remember the victims of the deadly Egyptian plane crash. It is yet to be proven as to whether it's terrorism or not, but we will pray for a safer world. And then I learned this morning at the first service of a car accident in which both drivers in a head-on crash on the other side of Morganton were killed, and the daughter who was in a school here locally, was in surgery for brain surgery in Charlotte. And her mother is in critical condition with many broken bones. So without knowing the name of that family, we'll keep them in our prayers. Let us turn to God. We come to you, O God, on this Trinity Sunday, acknowledging that you are both creator, that you are the Redeemer, in Jesus Christ. We also acknowledge that you are the one who sustains us in this life through the power of your Holy Spirit. And so we come to an understanding of that mystery as part of your identity and claim that great grace that you've revealed through yourself in three persons. We lift before you, God, those individuals in our church that are going through a time of great grief. For we know that you, as the author and giver of life, bless and ordain our lives with your love and encourage us in our living to keep our awareness of life sacred because of its tenuous nature. And when we experience the death of a son of this church, like the death of Kevin Christenberry, we ask that you will certainly be at work through his brother Steve, his other brother Casey, and through Linda's life as his mother, but also through Brenda Welburn, who was his aunt. We pray, O Lord, for your comfort and guidance to be with all those who grieve. And we lift up Hattie Roston's family, her children, Steve and June and Renee, and ask your blessing to be with them and their families as they grieve Hattie's death. We're grateful, God, for lives that are fully lived, and certainly Hattie did that and lived a full and gracious life with many of us in the years that she served in this community at the bakery. We ask, O Lord, your direction and comfort to be with all families who grieve. We also lift to you with gratitude the commitment made yesterday in this church between a new husband and wife, Jane Burris and Kevin Dart. We ask that you will strengthen their marriage and guide them into the ways of a life well lived together, a life of love, a life of devotion and direction, and service to humanity. We pray, Lord, your comfort also with those who are in South America and Dolores, Uruguay, and the Waldensian church there in their loss of their facility, but even in a town larger than ours of the loss of 1,000 buildings and so many people who are left homeless as a result of that tragedy. We pray your comfort and your direction to provide them the support they need as they rebuild. We pray, Lord, for difficult situations in the world where there is terrorism and the suspicion of terrorism around the Egyptian plane crash. Lord, too many victims have already died at the hands of hatred, and they continue to do so, and we ask that you will direct the world in its fervent and clear response to bring hatred under control, knowing that ultimately that hatred has to be resolved through love. And we ask your love to guide this world to a greater peace. We ask, Lord, your direction also for this church and its ministry and outreach. Guide and help us as we seek to remain faithful to you and to serve as a living witness to the power of the Holy Trinity at work in this congregation through our ministries of care and support to others. We ask these things in confidence, for we pray them in the name of the one who taught us to pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. merciful Lord, open us anew to your truth. We seek to be guided by your Holy Spirit and our understanding of it as revealed to us in Scripture. In Jesus' name, amen. From John, the 16th chapter, starting with the 12th verse. Jesus is talking to his disciples, anticipating his death and resurrection. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now, so very often times in the past, when we focused on the Trinity, we get easily caught and lost in the high weeds of theological nuance. Because the Trinity is a hard thing, as John very clearly said to the children, it's not only hard for kids to understand, it's difficult for adults to understand. I've got whole books, large books, on the Trinity, and some of them will make anybody, including a trained theologian, to scratch their heads. Am I right, Jim? Here in this passage this morning, we hear the words of Jesus tell us that his teachings will reflect the will of God. We also recognize here in this passage that the Holy Spirit then conveys those truths that he learns from Jesus and passes them on to God's people. And as much as we'd like to get into the nuance of the Holy Spirit and the Trinity, I think this morning's focus helps us to direct our attention to the Trinity, and to particularly the role of the Holy Spirit in the Trinity. And to help us when thinking with that, I'm mindful of an Eastern Orthodox icon of the Holy Trinity, where there, in fact, I've used that in here, I think, 3 years ago when I preached, where the Father is seated in the center and slightly elevated above the Son and the Holy Spirit. Interestingly enough, in that icon, all three, Father, Son, who is on the right hand always of God the Father, but we're looking at it, the Son is on the left, and then the Holy Spirit, who all three images are the same. Father, Son, Holy Spirit in this particular icon. And that's for a purpose. You see, the Eastern Orthodox Christians helped the West to understand something that we kind of missed out on and didn't quite accurately interpret. And that's the relational nature of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And when we're thinking about that Trinity, certainly all three of those persons of the Trinity are of the same being, that they reflect the will of each other in their own identity. So that Jesus reflects the will of the Spirit, and if we think of the Spirit a little bit more broadly than just his gift to the church, but if we recognize that at creation, God, who is the Creator Father, creates the whole world, and there is something given to the world, even on the second day of creation. The wind, the breath, the Spirit of God, hovers over the face of the deep and separates the waters of the earth from the waters of the sky. So the Trinity is as old as the hills. It goes all the way back to creation itself, where the Holy Spirit is a partner with God in creation. One of the parallel texts for us this morning that we did not choose to read here but is available is from Proverbs 8, in which it talks about the Spirit as being a gift called wisdom that is given by God and that is present with God in creation. So understanding this, there is one phrase that I want to talk about here, that, or one statement that comes from St. Augustine of the 4th century. And if you think of those images, Father in the center, Son on the right hand of God, and Holy Spirit on the left, listen to this, and I think it'll make a little more sense. It is the Father only who is not of another. For the Son is born of the Father, the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father. But the Father is neither born of nor proceeds from another. And yet this should not occasion in human thought any idea of disparity between the Supreme Trinity. For the Son is equal to the Father of whom he is born, just as the Holy Spirit is equal to him from whom he proceeds. That's a long way around to saying that they all are equal in importance, and all of them have different roles in the life of God's people and the community of faith. A key phrase for us to focus on this morning comes from verse 13. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. So what does that mean for us as Christians? That the Spirit of God guides God's people into God's truth. When you think of Presbyterians, we are commonly aware that we elect elders to serve as the ruling body of the church. Elders make the decisions not only about Christian education and the ongoing routine life of the church and its functions, they also are the ones who are encouraged to discern the mind of God, the mind of Christ at work in the church. How do we do that? Now, it's a common assumption, because we are Americans, that we think that elders should be representing a constituency in the church. Now, it is the responsibility of every elder to listen to the people, and if there are issues that come up in the life of the church, to be able to convey them to the rest of the session. Now, that's another term. Let me define session. Session only occurs when the 12 elders and the pastor have gotten together for a called meeting. And a meeting in which the pastor is the moderator and the elders, up to 12, if they can all be present, great. But they have to have a minimum of 7, one more than half, in order for the business of the church to occur. Why is that so? We believe as Presbyterians and the elders of the church are called to discern the mind of Christ. So we listen first in the congregation, and we hear the issues, and we explore the perspective of what's going on in the church. And we bring that to the meeting. But then is when the real serious work begins. Because when we are gathered as a session of elders and pastors, discerning the mind of Christ, we are called to listen to each other, listening for the scriptural truth that is revealed in the conversations that we have. And when we as a session feel we've talked about this issue enough, we understand what the decision needs to be made, and we really genuinely believe that this reflects the will of God for the church. And we vote. And very often, the vast majority of votes in session are almost always unanimous, or 11 out of 12, or if it happens to be that two people are missing, 9 out of 10. We're pretty clear. And it helps to reassure me as a pastor that we have been at work seeking the mind of Christ. That's being guided into the truth in a very real and Presbyterian way. But there are other ways, other truths that we believe that we have learned by being God's people together that I'd like for us to give consideration to. What are some of those truths that we believe that we've learned from the Spirit of God? First truth is that we believe that when we gather together as a community of faith, again, here's the relational nature of the Trinity. It's very important for us to understand the role and importance of relationship in the decision-making of the session and relationship in the function of the church. When we gather together to worship God, we do it much better than we can as individuals on the golf course or individuals in the woods hiking. And for those, at times, all of us have those moments in which we think, you know, I have really had an encounter with God in nature that I couldn't have in the church. And that's true. You can have that. But to assume that that is the only way in which we encounter God and the best way in which we encounter God is to miss the importance of relationship as Christians. Because we are called to be together from birth through older adult life. And that when we celebrate who God is and discern God's will for our lives together in study and in proclamation of the word, then we are about the business of seeking the truth of God. We also believe, as Christians and as Presbyterians, that every single person matters. Is that not true? So by the time a child is baptized into this church, or even born before they're baptized, born into this church, we recognize them as being a child of God. That role, that identity, that status stays with them until the time they die. We are blessed in this church with individuals who now are one over and one approaching the age of 100. And from the moment we're born until the moment we die, we are children of God. And that's an identity truth that we recognize that the Spirit has guided us to. And that means that throughout our lives as a community of faith, that when someone is going through a great crisis, that we matter. We are not going through that crisis alone. And this church is absolutely stellar in your willingness to respond to people that are going through grief. Many of you have experienced that, and those same individuals have given that. Presence of the church, of God's truth in tangible forms in our lives when a person is grieving and is struggling for me. That's a relational truth that the Spirit of God gives us. Another one that is profoundly important to every one of our lives is the role that we realize that in Christ we are called to forgive when we've been wronged. And what happens when we do not forgive and we harbor hatred and even sometimes shame over an experience we've had with other human beings? That shame and that hatred and that whole negative stuff going on in our lives creates us to be something that we're not and tends to separate us from that which is our identity, relationship with God, and even relationship with the person who's done us wrong. And what we realize about forgiveness is that the person who's unwilling, unable to forgive, their lives are distorted worse. That is a relational truth that God's Spirit tells us. That a lack of forgiveness on our part makes us into something that we're not supposed to be. And it hides that sense of joy, that sense of identity as being God's own, forgiven and redeemed by Christ, and willing to exert that same kind of forgiveness in others. Wednesday night, when we gather together for the dinner and then the program afterwards on the community garden, I was struck about another relational truth. How the Spirit of God enters into people's lives and convicts them in a way of service in a way that they had not thought of before an opportunity came around. Like serving in the community garden, we have fortunately a number of members who are actively engaged in that. That didn't exist 3 years ago. How do we explain that other than the Spirit of God convicts individuals to say, I believe in this ministry and I'm willing to engage in it. And so we look at that as an example and we branch out from that and realize 30 new people that are on a call commission that are willing to engage in a relationship with each other and service to Jesus Christ. Because we've been convicted by the truth of God. You see, relational truth changes us all. And if we live by relational truth that comes from the gift of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, we are being transformed, changed into the image of Jesus Christ every day. So that we're still individuals. Still of an identity unto ourselves, but we are profoundly related to each other by something that unites the gift of love, the gift of being a child of God with each other. You're not going to find that in the world, in any service club or anything else, that sense of profound family identity with each other that God alone in Christ gives us as Christ Church. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I would like to invite you. I chose the Nicene Creed this morning. It's not one we're really familiar with, so it's printed in your bulletin. But it is a wonderful statement on the gift of the Trinity to us in the Church. Let us stand and share it together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human for our sake. He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. Just a couple of weeks ago, a Waldensian asked me, when we say that we believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church, and was confusing that Catholic with the Roman Catholic. If you look at the word holy Catholic, you see it's a small C. It conveys the universal Church, of which the Roman Catholics and the Protestants are all a part. But this is our belief in the universality of Christ's Church in the world. So it's not the same as saying we believe in the Romans. We believe in the greater universal Church. Let us now with confidence give of our lives and our gratitude to God. and very deep way. So we offer our lives and our gifts in gratitude for those wondrous gifts. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.